Is everything working here? You see?
Okay. No, no clicker, thank you. So, sorry again. Also, you prepare a lot, then you see they still have troubles. It's a pleasure to be here. I hope you have a lot of energy left, because you will get a lot of information. It's a pleasure to present you the next decade's seven game-changing forces. First of all, I want to start with this quote from Bill Gates, which is already 22 years old. It was in one of his books in 1996, where he aptly stated that we always overestimate the change that will occur in the next 2 years, but we underestimate the change that will occur in the next 10. And it's still true, and I think it will be still true in some decades. There was also yesterday a very interesting statement from Google's CEO, Sundar Pichai, which I really appreciated, because there was the question, would technology solve our problems of the future? And his honest answer was the concept that technology could solve humanity's problems, as many politicians try to imply, is just out of touch with reality. And he's completely right, as we will see. So technology is an enabler, but the problems of the humanity we have to solve ourselves. So what are these seven game-changing forces? They also will rewrite the world's economy operating system. That's the most rapid urbanization, demographics, the energy challenge, and the climate change, material and biotechnologies, globalization, entrepreneurship, and digital transformation, that's digital arena. So I try to give you an overview, especially for the first six, and then we dive a bit more into the seventh ones. Also, it's just an overview again, because usually every chapter would be just half an hour talk. So the urbanization, the most rapid urbanization. Having cities, meaning cities of a million inhabitants, or mega cities, which are defined with over 10 million inhabitants, it's quite a new thing. So if we see in 1900, 20% or 2 out of 10 people lived in cities. Today, we have already 54% living in cities. That means the majority of the population of the globe. And in 2050, it's expected by the UN that 7 out of 10 people will live in cities. This has a huge side effect, because the speed of this transformation and change occurs especially from emerging countries. One of the side effects is, if you look to the so-called center of the economic center of gravity, which is done, it's a calculation done by the London School of Economics. They just take the globe and from every country, the GDP, and watch and compare it how it evolves over the times. So if we start from year one, the center, the economic center of gravity stayed between China and India for 1,500 years. But then there was the Industrial Revolution, which started in Britain, as you know. And from that moment on, it moved towards the West for around 100 years. Then we had World War I and II, and because Europe was quite damaged economical-wise, it moved to the US till the 1950s. And then when Europe recovered, it came back. Then in the 1980s, there was a big step forward because the Japanese catched in with their economy. But so far, the fastest step was here from the year 2000 to 2010 in the direction of Asia. And it's predicted that in 2025, it will be more or less back in Asia, in China concretely. What does it mean, for example, just one of these side effects? In 2000, 95% of the Fortune Global 500 companies were headquartered in developed countries. Not so anymore in 2025, because then in emerging markets, especially in China, there will be the home of more large companies than either in the United States or in Europe. So it's so important that we stop looking to the West. We have to start looking to the East. That's the future. Just a little example as well about all these cities. We have just a small look to China, because nearly a quarter of the top 200 cities in 2025 will be located in China. So these are all emerging cities. You see the red dots here, these are the new entrants for 2025, and the blue are already in the ranking of the top 200 cities since 2010. So let's look just to Tianjin. Maybe you know it. This was this city where I think 3 years ago there was this huge explosion in the container harbor, with many people were killed. However, Tianjin has had in 2010 already a GDP, more or less, just the city, from 130 billion, that's the size of Stockholm. And by 2025, just the city will have estimated a GDP of 625 billion. That's the size of Sweden's economy. Okay, so what we are seeing here is there are cities already here and arising in China. They will be stronger or bigger than some European countries. There's also very good news about it, because this fast, rapid urbanization put out so many people from poverty and adds them to the so-called consuming class. So by 2025, compared from 1990, we will add 3 billion people to the consuming class. So it will be the first time in history that the majority of the people on the globe will be consumers and not anymore in the poverty state. And another important thing to know is, in 2010, in emerging countries, the most money was spent. Just one third came, the developed markets. Just one third came from the emerging markets. But in 2025, it's nearly half. That means that these emerging countries will spend around 30 billion, a trillion a year, and spend more or less the half of the economy, world spending in the emerging markets. So you should be there as well. What does it mean? If you look beyond, probably 2035, the European Union, with the left 27 countries, will not be among the biggest economies anymore because of the rise of China and India. The second disruptive force is the disruption. Like it or not, the fertility rate is falling dramatically, as we know, and the population in the world is growing dramatically, which is good that we all can enjoy our life longer, but on the other hand, it's a big problem, because in the meantime, in 60% of the world's population is living in countries where the fertility rate is below the replacement rate, as you can see here in this chart. So the replacement rate which we would need is in normal, as in established countries, 2.1 kids per woman or birth, or in the emerging countries, 2.5. But as you can see, even in China, it's far below Brazil, Germany, and so on. That's the reason why the population is shrinking, including in China, even in Germany, except in Africa. Another problem which we face is that within the next 10 years, one third of the world's labor workforce will retire. And if you compare here from this chart, the number of retirees per 10 children, you see in 2025 we have far more retired people compared to the children and the youngsters, and this trend will continue. So it's really a question who will pay for the pensions in the future. For the businesses, it's important to know this trend, because you cannot just watch and stand still. You have to do something about it, because soon, probably in the next 3 to 5 years, all the consumers will make up already the larger portion of the market, and they will be consumers for a very long time, and you need to know this reality and change your business approach. The third disruptive force is the energy challenge and the climate change. First of all, we are all consuming far too much of energy, in that way that we don't have enough renewable energy. So if this trajectory will go on in the future, that we still have an increase of energy demand, which I think is the case, then you can expect within, let's say, 7 to 15 years, especially in Europe and so on, very harsh measurements from governments, because they need to force us to reduce the energy consumption. Otherwise, we can't stop the climate change, and it will become really terrible. So who is consuming so much energy? From the sector, it's very easy. The biggest one is the industry, the red one. The second biggest one is the building industry. The third one is the transport. And then are the non-combusted. So let's us look just to the cars, because we all use cars. And I have terrible news for you here, or for the world, because at the moment we have around over 1 billion cars on the globe. In the year 2000, we had 600 million. And the not so very good news is in 2040, we will have 2 billion cars. And from these 2 billion cars, as you can see on this blue field, we will have just a tiny fraction of electric cars, which is also good news, because electric cars are the stupidest thing we ever invented, as I will show. So, also the consumption of the combustion engines will really be reduced over the next two decades, which is fine. The green or the electric cars are not that green as you might think. Actually, it's a disaster. Electric cars need batteries, as we know. And to produce these battery cells, which are just these dischargeable battery cells you have for your use at home as well, and then they are just backed up, you need these huge gigafactories. So, if you think about 2030, it's expected that we produce 80 million cars per year, new cars, okay? If we go for the aim, as the governments want, that 30% of it will be electric, fine for that, it will just not happen, because the batteries are just not available at all, which is a good news as well, because if you would produce from these 80 million, 30%, electric cars, you would have to produce 24 million electric cars. So you would need a capacity of 3,000 gigawatts for the electricity. That means you need 100 factories to produce just these new electric batteries. Not for replacement or anything else, just 100 batteries. And today, we don't even have 5 of these gigafactories. That's the reason why companies like Audi can't just deliver this new e-tron, because they don't get the batteries. They are just not available. Why is it a good news as well? Because it's stupid to produce these batteries. Producing these batteries causes, in the process to produce the battery, I'm not talking about the mining and all this stuff, which is also nothing special, very welcomed. It has a negative effect, because to produce the batteries, you have as much pollution as you would drive a Volkswagen Golf over 8 years with 12,000 kilometers a year. Can you imagine? And the thing is that these batteries will not last for 8 years, because usually they are, you can use them 4, maybe 5, maybe 7 years, then you have to replace them. So all in all, it's just stupid. If you compare it in the reality, I think this is a nice example. The Fiat 500 model from 1967, for example, had 500 kilos. Just 17 brake horsepower, but it was enough. And the footprint was just 4 square meters. Today's model 500 has 940 kilos, so we nearly doubled the weight. And it's not just Fiat. You can take BMW, Mercedes, whatever you like, Mini. It's everywhere the same. So you have more brake horsepower. Of course, you need also more brake horsepower to move such more weight. And the footprint, because we enjoy having some space in the car, has increased by 50%. Now, let's have a look to the Fiat 500e, which is, by the way, not available in Europe, but in California. And my friend, the CEO of Aston Martin, has one imported as well. However, the weight of this electric car, and this car has no combustion engine, of course not. It's electric and has battery. Weighs over 400 kilos more. That means when you are moving this car on the road, you need to move even 400 kilos more for nothing. And even if some people think if they charge the battery from the plug, it's green because it's just the plug. Someone has to produce this electricity. It's just mad. So the fourth disruptive force is material and biotechnology. Here we are really changing the building blocks of nearly everything when we are talking about material. There are interesting things happening because they have special characteristics, these materials: greater strength, less weight, unusual electrical property, self-healing, self-cleaning, improved conductivity, and so on. And you should watch this field of emerging DNA material sciences, because you know that from the genes we have analyzed the sequence of the genes for the humans. I will come to that as well. But the same is happening now for materials. Because if we know the DNA of nearly every material, we have the good chance that we just can simulate on a computer which kind of mix of materials gives us the best characteristics for a special for this and this purpose and use. So this will be a huge business as well, and some companies are already very successful in some niches. Also, nanotechnologies are part of this. You have heard of nanotechnologies. You can have special paints for planes or for cars or for coats. Then they are never dirty, they are never wet. But you find nanomaterials in even for the bicycle frames and so on. But nanomaterials are also not very good news, as I will explain. So nanomaterials you find, for example, in car bodies made of carbon. Or here you can see the first artificial kidney. It's working properly. It's an implant you get with a microchip technology. Then you have a concrete made of carbon. We have already from nanomaterials artificial brains and organs. You have bioelectronics. You can put it in a body with a surgery. It's with dissolving sensors. Or we have this new featherweight nanoceramics, which means you can, even if you have a huge bridge, carry it with just two people. It's very, very light and so on. But the problem is, and this, it's very interesting, nobody's talking about, at least not officially, these nanomaterials are really bad news, dangerous at the moment. So we all know the problem with the plastic and the microplastic in the sea. This is just such a tiny problem compared to the nanomaterials. Why? The microplastic, if we want, we can filter, we can collect and recycle. Costs a lot of money, costs a lot of efforts, okay. But nanomaterials is a manipulation on the molecular level. There is no filter. There is no filtering technology available. If these materials go into the environment, they go mad because they will go through all the cell membranes. They will really ruin a lot. This will have disastrous consequences in 30, 40 years. What could you do? There would be a regulation needed that the manufacturers are forced to implement a self-destroying mechanism, which is possible, but so far no country has gone into this field. Then, as you know, we have the sequencing of the DNA. It was a mega project, started in the 90s. It was the equivalent like the building the Panama Canal. It took 13 years and it cost $3 billion. And today, you can have DNA sequencing from a supercomputer, which can do 20,000 analyses from the genomes in a year, less than $1,000. What is the consequence here? As you have heard, maybe even from yesterday, from China, the future of natural selection is gone. So we will see more and more of these things, which we have seen now in China, that we are starting to design bodies and body parts and so on and so on. Also, there's an outcry. I would agree. I promise you, it's such a big business, it will not stop here. It will go ahead. The fifth disruptive force is the globalization. What does this mean? Globalization is the degree to which the world is much more connected through trade, capital and finance, people and information. So, for example, just in the past 30 years, the trade has tenfolded. even the flow of goods or the flow of services, as you can see from the left to the right side, or from finance. Global capital flows expanded 25 times between 1980 and 2007, then fell sharply in the aftermath of the 2008 financial crisis, and then bounced back, and today it's estimated to be nearly up to 6 trillion. Same is with the flow of data, same is with the flow of traveling from people around the world, etc. But what you should watch is this project from the Chinese. It's called the Belt and Road Initiative, this Silk Road. They want to have a special belt overland corridor, a maritime road for the shipping lanes, and they're investing over $1 trillion in this huge project to create their or extend their global dominance. What are the consequences? First of all, it's the largest infrastructure project we have seen in history, covering more than 68 countries, 65% of the world's population, and more than 40% of global GDP. But you should watch this. The complementary investment projects here will be, for this project, $900 billion a year for the next decade. This will suck as much money from the market that we will be forced, the financial markets, to increase the interest rates. You will see, this will happen. So globalization in the traditional sense, that means trade volumes relatively to the GDP, might have peaked soon. Now it's more services, financial flow, and so on. Sixth disruptive force is entrepreneurship. And there's a reason why the digital giants are digital giants, giants, because they don't lead by accident, they disrupt deliberately. And if you see such a quote from, for example, Jeff Bezos, when he says, entrepreneurs must be willing to be misunderstood for long periods of time, then you know what I'm talking about. And where lies the problem? We in Europe, or especially also in the OECD countries, we have the majority of SMEs, small and medium-sized companies. 95% of all these companies are SME companies. They employ 70% of all people, and they contribute to the GDP between 50 and 60%. It's a huge, huge thing. But till 2025, 60% of them will be killed. Again, till 2025, 60% of today's SMEs will be killed because they cannot keep up with the digitization. They don't join the digital ecosystems. They are not prepared. They don't understand what is happening. And so they will just be put out of the market, which is sad, especially for Europe. Why is this happening? Because the power of the digital giants is just growing enormously. You can, even today, or at least 2021, for example, of all online transactions, for more than 20%, you need the digital giants. And this will just increase crazily. Large enterprises, they can defend, and they will keep up, as you see. So that's not the problem. But the SMEs from today will just be in a special position as sandwich, and they might die, a lot of them. And digital startups will still be born, and they will also grow in their number of shares. So what's happening now? It's not changing anymore. The next problem which we have in the entrepreneurship is that we are ruining the culture of entrepreneurship, because especially the startup scene is going the wrong way. Very few make it to the sea. Many people turtles hatch, as you know, and that's a huge problem. So even our problem in Europe is that we always want to copy the US, yeah, because they are the heroes. I already told you, look to the east, not to the west. However, US was seen as a startup nation, but in reality, the entrepreneurship is actually on decline, and this is since decades happening. So there's this guy, Karl Schramm, who is the former president CEO of Kaufmanns Foundation, the the wealthiest foundation in the US for startup things. And they have done all this analysis and found out that the problem is so many youngsters want to become also a billionaire overnight, want to copy Steve Jobs and Bill Gates and all this, which is crazy, because just 5 to 7% is the share of this kind of businesses in the market. They get the biggest attention from media and from the financial investors, but they have the highest rate in failure. 80% of them are disappearing within 8 years, so there's really a lot of things wrong. And we have overlooked what the real successful entrepreneurs are. First of all, they never went to college. The average entrepreneur is nearly 40 years old when he launches. I'm talking about the successful ones. More than 80% of all new companies are started by people over 35 years. More entrepreneurs are between 45 and 55 than any other cohort. Entrepreneurs over 55 now create more companies than those under 35 years. Hello? That's the reality. And the average entrepreneur was an employee for almost 15 years before launching startup. I'm talking about the successful entrepreneurs. And there's another surprise. The older someone is who is creating a company, the more successful he becomes. Of course, because experience matters. So, and I also like very much this analysis and result. I don't know whether you know him, Andrew Young. He was a long time responsible at the Barack Obama administration, the White House, for the startups. Now he's even a presidential candidate for 2020. And he really discovered that entrepreneurship education just doesn't work. First of all, it started in the 80s. How many of these professors there, meaning it good, ever worked in a company or have been a business guy, a successful? You will not find 1%. Otherwise, they would have stayed as an entrepreneur and not a professor. So how should they learn, youngsters, how to run a successful business? They just can't. They have no idea. And that's one of the problems. And even in America, the numbers are stark. The more entrepreneurship is they are teaching, the fewer young people actually starting businesses or survive. So the seventh disruptive force is the digitization and the digital arena. First of all, it's undeniable that we have the digital age. As you can see here from this famous analysis, till the year 2000, we have had the majority of information analog. But in 2002, there was this tipping point of the beginning of the digital age where 50% of all information were already digital. And look here, by 2007, already 94%, you see, in just 5 years were digital. That means we have definitely an explosion of data. And you have no idea usually what explosion it is. It's enormous. If we just look back to the year 2007, we have had 295 exabytes of information digitally. I give you one little idea. All the printed wisdom of the world, the knowledge of the world, the printed is 0.2 exabytes. All the printed, whatever it is, a magazine, all the libraries, Bibles, whatever you want. It's just 0.2 exabytes. In 2007, we already had 295 exabytes. If you would have burned CD-ROMs to store this information, you know, with 700 megabytes each, that's piling up from the Earth to the Moon and a quarter more in 2007. In 2020, we will have 27,500 exabytes. That means the CD-ROMs will pile up 160 times from Earth to the Moon. Can you imagine? And is it over? Is the growth rate over? No, still. 97% of all the generated information were generated in the last 5 years. It will still explode. And that's the reason why we are talking about machine learning and all these algorithms, because simply having information won't offer a competitive edge. Knowing what to do with it will. So, and it will not stop. We have this digital mesh, we have all these different devices, you know, even for pets and the handbags and clothing, and everything will become digital. It's just exploding. And then, as you know, 5G will come at 2020. This will be a huge game changer as well, because it's 1,000 times faster, and it's built for 7 billion people, 7 trillion things, and so on and so on. And you have no latency anymore. So Internet of Things, especially, will be the game changer, because the Internet of Things will mainly happen without human users. So whatever thing you have, from a TV to a fridge to a sensor, will be digitized and will be connected to the internet more or less sooner or later. So today we have around 10 billion Internet of Things devices. In 2020 it will be between 30 and 60, but in 2025 we will already have 500 billion Internet of Everything devices. And they will create a hell of a lot of amount of data. So let's have a look into the machine intelligence, because there's so much nonsense around about it, what it is and what we have to think about this. So we have three circles. A is the circle which defines the human abilities. B is what machines could do historically, and C, what machines can do currently. And as you know, there are very famous warnings. One is from Stephen Hawking. Success in creating AI would be the biggest event in human history. Unfortunately, it might also be the last, unless we learn how to avoid the risk, and so on. So artificial intelligence is not a new thing. It's around, by the way, even from since the 18th of century, because all the mathematics for the algorithms, for the probability, is going back to Thomas Bayes and his theories, which we still use, so from the 18th century. Then we had, of course, the 1915 with Alan Turing, and so we had again and again a start, how can machines think, and it flopped again and again over all these decades. So when we are talking about what is intelligence, consciousness, intuition, memory, learning, creativity, wisdom, whatsoever, there is no definition. These are just a few definitions. You can even look up yourself from all these wise researchers of the world what artificial intelligence means, from the Oxford Dictionary to Bellman and so on. They're all different. So how can we talk about artificial intelligence if we even don't know and understand what it is? We can't. So one should maybe try to align it. For example, I like very much this quote from Mark Dexmark, it's a Swedish-American guy. Intelligence is the ability to accomplish complex goals. Then, of course, it's important to understand the narrow intelligence. That's what we have today. For example, driving a car, playing chess, speech recognition and all this stuff. But what everyone is worrying about AGI, artificial general intelligence, which means the ability to accomplish any cognitive task at least as well as humans. And strong AI is the same like AGI. And then we have the super intelligence, which means the general intelligence, which is far beyond human level, the explosion of intelligence. Coming back to the reality. There's a guy called a professor, Judah Birl, an Israeli-American scientist and philosopher. He was the one who started the machine learning thing, because he is the guy for the probability, for the algorithm. And there's a new book, if you are interested to read it, The Book of Why, where he is bitterly complaining that there is no progress at all since 25 years in this science, and that we still can't compute cause and effect, that still these impressive achievements of deep learning amount just to curve fitting, and here that's the most important thing, if a machine does not have a model of reality, you cannot expect the machine to behave intelligently in that reality. So we are really far, far, far away from anything which deserves the name intelligent. What is it? The difference between machine learning, all the stuff is, normally when a programmer develops a program, he is using deterministic approaches. But in machine learning, you switch to probabilities. So training a machine learning algorithm, for example, you learn him with, let's say, 50,000 photos, pictures of a cat, and 50,000 of a horse, and 50,000 of a car. They are labeled cat, horse, car, and then the machine will understand one day what is a cat and what is a car. But at the end, it will always result in a probability. It says it's not 100% a cat, but maybe 99.2%. So that's the problem. There are different levels, but we won't have the time. But the most important thing is, and that's also interesting, no one is talking about really, if you have a machine learning algorithm, it's nice, but the most important thing is how you train it, how clean, objective, and real are the data, or are they dirty? Because, for example, if you would train a machine learning algorithm with all the statements of President Trump, what do you think the machine learning algorithms would take for granted and as the truth, the reality? So it just won't work. But are there reasons to worry about this? Yes, because it's already killing these narrow intelligence jobs. We have ethical questions, privacy problems, and so on. And we have the problem in the future, if one day we would have super intelligence, this would just outperform us all. And also we are the life 2.0, so to speak, so our hardware, the body is given, but we can design much of our software by training and learning. But life 3.0, which would be then happening, could also design its own hardware and software and become the master of its own destiny. So how long will it take until we have machines greatly superseded human level at AGI, no one knows. There is no certainty. Some say it's this century, some say it's next, no one knows. But here's the reason why I think we really have to deal with it, because you never know. Perhaps you know these two examples. Ernest Rutherford, arguably the greatest nuclear physicist of his time, said in 1933, less than 24 hours before Leo his invention of the nuclear chain reaction, that nuclear energy was moonshine. The smartest guy in the field said it's impossible, and 24 hours later, a colleague invented it. Or 1956, astronomer Royal Richard Woolley called talk about space travel at the village, and we know in 1969 we have been on the moon, we others. So let's compare as humans to machines. There's bad news and good news. Bad news is we have lost most of the areas already against technology. Good news is there are still some important things left. First of all, we compare ears versus microphones. We humans can detect frequencies between 20 and 20 kHz, up to 120 decibel. And the localization with both ears, when we through a room listen to someone, we know in 5 degrees where this guy is talking to us. Technology can, in a frequency, listen to from 20 to the gigahertz area, even to ultrasound, can take up to 220 decibel, which is the start of a Saturn V rocket. And it will not be ruined, and the localization is much finer. That's the reason why you see all these things like Alexa and so on working very well. If we compare ears versus cameras, we have lost two. Our resolution is 0.1 millimeters. Angstrom is 1 million times better. Our speed, we can see 1/100th of a second. And technology already can deal with picoseconds. That means that's faster than light. The frequency, we can see, because in the electromagnetic field, we can just see the rainbow area, 430 to 770 terahertz, and technology can more or less see everything. We have two eyes, and this 100,000 means just look to London, there are 100,000 eyes around you. So that means from the electromagnetic field, from the whole spectrum, we as humans can just see this small part. And that's the reason why one day, but it will take quite some time, autonomous cars have a chance, because they have 6 to 16 cameras LiDAR, radar, ultrasound, and all this stuff as well. And so they will be, and by the way, they have then also the information from the car before and behind, and from all CCTVs around in cities and streets and roads. But here we are still winning. That's the good news when we compare brain to computers. The size of a neuron is just 20 microns. A transistor is 1,000 times smaller. When our neurons are firing, it's in a millisecond. The processor does it with 1 million times faster. But we have 1 billion neurons. The best chip has just 10 billion transistors. And here we go. We have between 1 trillion and 1 quadrillion of synapses, which means connections. And the computer can just deal with a fraction. And we consume 20 to 30 watts. And if you want to simulate a brain, no one knows how it works, we would need at least 200 kilowatts. Can you imagine? Our brain with 1.25 kilos needs just 20 to 30 watts to run, and a supercomputer would need 200. So I'm nearly running out of time. Let me close with a few more. The Moore's law, you know, doubling the processor speed every second year, it's gone. It's gone. That's, you would recognize it if you would have bought a PC the last 3, 4, 5 years. You always get 1 point, 2 point gigahertz, 3, 4, maybe 5. You have never seen one with 7 or 10. That's over. We are now down to 7 nanometers on a chip. That's it. That's done. So does it mean there will be no speed increase? No, it will be. There's a next processor generation. It's the parallelization. This Graph Core will be available next year. There are 7,000 processors on one chip. The chip is 1 inch by inch, and it's 100 times faster for machine learning. And the good thing is, if you compare just the power from supercomputers, this is the latest one from November, actually, the IBM Summit, which is able to compute 143.5 petaflops, consumes 15 megawatts of energy, another 15 for the cooling, and it could just compute, theoretically, a fraction of the brain computing power we have. And it costs 400 to 600 million, has 700 square meters footprint. However, I could go into deeper, I have to forget it. Quantum computers, you know quantum computers, I've heard. How to think about quantum computers, they are still not available commercial, forget it, but they will come. A fast processor, if you have a library and have to read or to scan all the information inside, will just sequentially read and process the information, one after the other. A quantum computer would just do it at once, whatever is available. That's it. So if this will come, it will also crack everything, including the blockchain. There is no blockchain anymore, because it will crack the encryption and so on. There's different states of the quantums, forget it. So let me close with this. What we have to see and to realize is about artificial intelligence in all these tiny steps we go ahead. I like this picture very much. This just, let's say, a Malta with Alps and the sea around. But the thing is, the sea is rising. So the ability, what we can do with computers, with software, with intelligence, is getting more, become more and more. And it will kill jobs. So it's not true that it will not kill jobs. And it's creating new jobs, fine, but we will kill more. And this is really a big, big problem. So let me stop here. I would have to tell you so much more, but forget it. Bad news for experts. Artificial intelligence, especially the machine learning, will kill these jobs too. Thank you very much.